I mean,
Exactly.
he has films, or has a film clip of George Meany denying that they got any money from the CIA, and then in the next segment he documents how they did get money from the CIA.
I say to you categorically now that it is not true. Well, under no circumstances have we ever received or solicited any money from the CIA.
It doesn't say that the AFL-CIO received it. The $33 million doesn't go to the AFL-CIO. It goes to the AIFLD.
Let me state that these unions you mentioned have stated just as categorically as I have that they do not receive and have not received CIA money.
The CIA's trade union operations are effected through a vast bureaucracy of people. These are the officers of the international trade unions and of the national unions, especially in the United States, through which the CIA is able to infiltrate and manipulate the international unions. Of course, Mr. Meany has been in the past one of the principal, if not the principal, U.S. trade unionist through which these operations are affected.
I'm Andy McClellan. I'm the inter-American representative of the AFL-CIO and have been since 1964. Prior to that time, I was the associate inter-American representative. And prior to that time, I was inter-American representative of the International Union of Food and Allied Workers, based in Geneva, but working in Latin America.
I'm the executive director of the American Institute for Free Labor Development. Prior to that time, as a matter of fact, I've been the executive director now for some 10 years, and I've been with the American Institute for Free Labor Development since its founding in 1962. For the period immediately prior to 1962, I was the Inter-American Representative of the Postal, Telegraph, and Telephone International, which has headquarters in Switzerland, but I was their representative in the Western Hemisphere.
There have been some people who have accused the AFL-CIO of collaborating with the CIA, and what would be your response to that accusation?
I think that is so ridiculous and so infantile, so juvenile, to make such an accusation.
And you, Mr. Dougherty?
Oh, I agree. I don't know of any labor leader that wouldn't out-and-out deny such an accusation. It's just not true.
In Latin America, one of the principal and most effective of the trade unionists, of the American trade unionists who worked with us, was Bill Dougherty. He had originally started in the Post, Telegraph, and Telephone Workers International, coming up through the Communications Workers of America. Later on, he was transferred into the American Institute for Free Labor Development. This was set up during the Kennedy period and is a joint effort by American trade unionists like George Meany and the heads of American-based multinational corporations which operate in Latin America.
Order is restored, but not before 11 persons are killed and a crippling general strike is called over the power struggle between the president and the parliament of Brazil.
Says Mr. Dougherty, quote, "What happened in Brazil on April 1st did not just happen. It was planned, and planned months in advance. Many of the trade union leaders, some of whom were actually trained in our institute, were involved in the revolution and in the overthrow of the Goulart regime."
Immediately prior to the military takeover in Brazil, there was a group of students from Brazilian unions in training in Front Royal. This wasn't the first of the Brazilian groups that have been here, nor has it been the last. We've had them continuously. They weren't in any kind of a course training for revolutionary activities or clandestine activities. They were in a regular collective bargaining course. It so happens that when many of those students went back home from that course, their unions were involved in this struggle against the attempt of the communists to take over some of the unions, and that's precisely